Welcome to this panel. The topic on this panel is European resistance. Our panelists today are Thomas Siebert from Rosa Luxemburg Stiftung. Also with us is Elisabeth Gauthier from Transform, Elena Papandopoulou from Nikos Poulantis Institute and also from Transform, and Lorenzo Marsili from European Alliances, if I said this correct. Alternatives, I'm sorry. So without any further ado, let me start this first round of questions. We have recently seen the elections in France and Greece. And my first question is then for Elena, that is for Elisabeth, to give us a little comment, maybe more a detailed analysis of what is going on in Greece and France, and what these election outcomes mean. What are the implications for the Eurozone crisis and the crisis of European integration in general? Over the past couple of years since this crisis started, we have seen the inability of the European elites to deal with these issues successfully. So my question is, are these election results, especially in Greece, where we have seen complete disintegration of political party system, are these outcomes good or bad in terms of devising a left strategy today? So maybe, Elena, you could start.
Okay, thank you. I'm really happy to be among you here today, and I have to say I'm here replacing Professor George Stathakis, who couldn't be here because he was unexpectedly elected a member of parliament in the area of Crete. And so you understand that in a very, very critical and serious period like this, he should be in Greece. So I would just like to make a comment of update because I'm sure that most of you follow quite closely the evolutions in Greece. Until last night that I was following the news, there was no possibility of the formation of a government. After 1 week of negotiations among the parties. It seems now that there is a new meeting tonight at 7:30 between the two former Greek parties, the party of PASOK, which is a socialist party that was crushed in the recent Greek elections, and the center-right party of New Democracy, with the participation of Syriza and the participation of a party called Democratic Left. The party of the Democratic Left is a party that came out of a split of our party, Synaspismos, a couple of years ago, and it was the first time it came down the elections and has a percentage of a force of 6% now. And until last night, there were rumors that there would be a coalition government between the two big parties and the party of the Democratic Left, which are still not validated, because Syriza has refused to participate in such a coalition government. So we just have to wait and see if this scenario is proved to be wrong, then we will have to go to new elections. That will probably be in beginning or mid of June, and whereas Eric Toussaint mentioned in the previous panel, the polls are showing that the party of Syriza is really rising in public opinion, and it will get even more support. So we'll start by giving you some data on what happened in the Greek elections, and then some comments. There was a really huge change in the political scenery of Greece, and that is what we have been talking about all this time, about a political crisis, which means a debunking of the social basis of the parties from their political expression, is now proving to be validated. So Syriza, the coalition of the radical left, a party that in the elections, the previous elections of 2009 had a power of 4%, now is the second biggest force in the Greek parliament. It has 52 seats and a percentage of 16.8%. The former biggest party, which is the party, the Socialist Party of PASOK, has really crashed from a percentage of 43.9% and 160 seats in the previous election to 13.18% and just 41 seats, and is the third power now in the parliament. And the party of the right, the New Democracy, which was the second party until now, and had 33% in the previous elections, now has a force of 18.8%. So that means together the two former big parties could not form a government because they were not holding the limit of 151 seats in the Greek parliament in order to do that. The other forces that entered the parliament this time was a party called the Independent Greeks. This was a party that came out of the split of New Democracy because it opposed austerity policies on a ground of reclaiming a strong independent Greece. It's also the party, the Communist Party of Greece, which until now was the third force in the Greek parliament. Now it's the fifth force. It has a marginal increase, but in general, everyone can note is that since the dissolution of the political system is of such a big degree, it was really not reinforced in these elections. There are reasons for that, but I won't go into this now. Inside the parliament, there is also the party of the Democratic Left that I mentioned earlier, which has 6%. And unfortunately, the entry of the fascist party of Golden Dawn, which has immensely increased its power from a really, really marginal force of 0.2% in the previous elections. It now has 7% and 21 seats in the parliament, and it's a really a very disturbing evolution and very, very new for us in Greece. So coming now to basically two questions. What was the situation more or less in Greece before the elections, and in this sense, how was the situation preparing the electoral result? And was the result actually expected? As I think all of you have an idea, since the last 2 years, Greece has been playing the role of a big laboratory. It was a laboratory for economic policies, meaning that what was tested was the result of a program of extreme austerity in an advanced capitalist country. Secondly, for the margins that the expected social reaction would take. And thirdly, for the form and for the magnitude that they also expected at some degree a political reaction would have. So on the economic level, things are rather well known. For the last 2 years, Greece had to go through one of the most aggressive programs of economic adjustment applied on the developed world. The cumulative reduction of the Greek GDP was huge. It's now going through the fourth year of a very big recession. For the third semester of 2012, it's minus 8%. Wages and pensions have been massively cut, sometimes up to, in some cases, up to 50%. The official unemployment rate is 22% for the whole of the country, but it's really 50% in between the young people and very, very acute in the areas, in some areas of the periphery of Greece and especially in northern Greece. And there is the expenditures for the social state are increasingly reduced, with the final goal, as it was mentioned in some of the recent SS reports of the IMF, they want to cut them to 30% of GDP. This is a huge.
To interrupt for a second, do you see? Having all these economic indicators, which are more or less well known, do you see any possibility that in the election in July, some sort of new left coalition will emerge in power? Do you think that there is a possibility for this radical left option to take power in Greece?
Yeah, sorry for going too much into the details. I just wanted to present the economic situation, which actually prepared the social situation of the wave of reactions, which is constituted of some big strikes that became bigger during the time, and then the eating movement that emerged during the summer. Right. And all these things actually started to prepare the ground for the electoral for the electoral result. The big success, one of the elements of the big success of Syriza, was that for the first time it claimed governmental power. So it said that we really want to form. It is a time to form a left government. However, it seems. It seemed until now, and we have to wait and see what will happen. The result in if elections will happen in July, whether this is actually a realistic scenario given the stance that the other forces of the left in Greece, which are the Communist Party and the Democratic Left, that are now members of the parliament, will take for or against the formation of such a government. And until now, what we have seen is that there is no real willingness, especially on the part of the Communist Party, to participate in such a government.
Yeah, thank you. Following this topic of left taking political power, question for Elizabeth. The Socialist Party of France is in fact now in power. What do you make of the Hollande new government? To what extent this socialist victory will change this main relationship between Germany and France that has really been the pillar of the austerity programs in Europe in recent years?
I think that there is now an open door, but nothing is done. Because, of course, we are happy that it's finished with Sarkozy, and this was a common aim for a lot of people, but it doesn't say what is the alternative. And it doesn't say what will be the balance of power in Europe. And so now the things we feel, it's very interlinked to what happens in Greece, in France, and in other countries. So there is no illusion on that with Hollande we will now change Europe. This is clear. But we see new possibilities to do it. In order to try to appreciate what are the possibilities, I would come back a little bit on what happened in this campaign. And also to tell you that it's not finished because we have to elect the parliament in June. So it will also depend of the balance of forces, how many, if the left will be the majority, if the socialists will be alone in the majority, or if they will need the voices from the deputies from the Front de Gauche, and so on. So there are a lot of open questions. But I think what is very interesting to see in our discussions here, and to go forward from the discussion from this morning, that in this campaign there happened something with the Front de Gauche. And this is for me the most interesting thing, but not for me only. Every journalist in France, the Observator, said that the real new thing in this campaign was the campaign of Front de Gauche. And so we have to ask ourselves why. And I think that we could resolve now, after long years of very difficult discussions, we could resolve some questions, not all, but some questions. And you remember in France, a very important event was 2005. Right. And this is our discussion here, the European fact that we refused the neoliberal European treaty, constitution treaty, but we didn't refuse Europe. And so we started, and it was a very, very hard discussion in this time, because you remember the Front National, the extreme right, the people, they were against Europe, and they asked to vote against this in the referendum, no, being against Europe, and we were obliged to develop really a left position. And I think that we made a very big walk in the society. It was not only on the head, it was really a citizen movement in this time with 1,000 collectives all around the country, with very important discussions, with participative discussions. And there, a lot of people could understand, and I think it's very important, and so I didn't agree with all was said before, that we are in a big, big class struggle in Europe. We are not in a struggle between nations. Of course, there is a translation in conflicts then also, but the found of all is that we are in a big crisis, and now it's more visible than in 2005. The found of the crisis is it's a big crisis of the capitalist accumulation reproduction system in the phases of the financial market capitalism. And in this period, the states and also the European construction with the institutions became market states. And market states are not social states. Market states are directed by oligarchies, and market states push us in the way of a post-democratic phases. And this constitution treaty was a very clear demonstration of this. And there we created a kind of fund in France to understand this. And this makes possible solidarity with other peoples, with other countries, with other class struggles, and avoid to be in a nationalist confrontation. And this is, for me, it's a decisive question today. Because if Merkel can isolate Greece people and the Greek left, for me, a left strategy is not implosion of Europe, because implosion makes ruins and make big, big risks. So I think that we need Europe, but of course we need another Europe. So the idea that we need another Europe became very important in France. And this was the reason that we could overcome the contradiction our enemies push always on the table. And the second thing I want to say, the Front de Gauche was the following step of this campaign, because we were able to bring together, this time in an election, in the question of in the challenge of an election, the most important actors of 2005. And this is the reason that we have left former left socialists. They were coming together with us in the Front de Gauche. The Communist Party in France was intelligent and not as the Greeks, and opened this way. After a long discussion and all this. And now we had a lot of people, they are not organized in parties, and since it's a front, it's an open space. And so in my circumscription, I have a lot of people, they are in no party at all, but they are very active actors in order to change the power. Because if you engaged for an electoral campaign, you want to change the power. And these people understood that now we are in a state in the European crisis, in a so dramatic situation, that we have to build new alliances between the people they speak on social movements and they speak on changing the powers. And it's not contradictory, it's complementary. And in this way, we could really make a new kind of campaign. And it's interesting when you say, and when everybody say, we have to take the streets. We took the streets with the campaign. And when we had in Marseille and in La Bastille, 100,000 people, and it's not an exaggeration, it was take the squares for changing power. Of course, we are not, we have 11 persons, and it's not enough, but we think that, and it's a reality, we could influence the landscape in France. And we could influence it because we pushed a pressure on the Socialist Party. And when the Socialists for a long time wanted to build a construction in the center with Bayrou and things like this, now it's finished. This is impossible. Now the gap between right and left is at new present in our country. And this is an important condition to progress in the discussion in the balance of forces. And we could, in the first time, really confront the Front National with a new kind of argumentation. It was not the argumentation, moralization, it was a class argumentation. We said the Front National is part of the maintain of the system and helps to transform the class struggle into nationalist struggle, into divisions inside the societies between poor and more poor and so on. So I think that we could really change the progress a little bit in the way of a new hegemony.
Thank you for this brief analysis of the situation in France, and I would just like to continue with this line of interrogation in terms of situation within each nation state. I would like to ask Thomas about the current situation in Germany. Germany being the center of the neoliberal project in Europe. I recall at one point that Friedrich Otto Wolff said that the German elites will have to learn to speak European if the Europe was to be sustained. So what's your take now? Are the German elites learning to speak European? Or do we have the opposite, really, a contraction within this conservative narrative?
Well, to start with, the German government at the moment is evidently on the winning side. It has imposed its idea of austerity politics, fiscal pact and divide on over the EU. But I would say the situation in Germany is much more complex. I will somehow go on in thesis to open that up for discussion. I will not so much have a coherent speech. So the first thing to say, I strongly join the position already said this morning, Germany is a declining power. You just have to think about how long do you think the Chinese are in need to buy German machinery? It will not take more than 10, 15 years. And German economy very much is depending on the export of these kind of sophisticated machines only German economy can produce. But how long do you think the Chinese will be in need of that? So I'm strongly sure it's a declining power. But then if you go internally into the society, we have a strong atmosphere of distrust and disappointment. And you can see this by the instability of the German political system. We have an absolute instability of this system. On the one hand, so it's made up by two parts. The one is clearly the majority at the moment backs the government. Just before I left Germany, there was a poll by newspapers, what do you think on Greece, and I think 78% of the Germans voted for to expel the Greeks from the EU. Yeah? That's on the one side. Why is that? We have on the level of the manufacturers, where you have these elections to the boards made up by the trade unions, we have strong victories of the trade unions, but only of the right-wing trade unionists. Those who say, I care for my manufacturer, I don't care for the working class in general, and especially not for the European working class, just my factory. Why? Because the people know that tomorrow the living conditions will be more worse than today. And they because there is no politics at the hand of the people. They are just looking for their personal advantage, and they know that right-wing unionists and conservative governments will support these interests, their private interests. But besides that, we have a complete post-democratic condition, as Elizabeth told it. So we have only 50 or 60% participating in the elections. The others don't participate in the elections. Nobody is talking on that. You said the Christian Democrats have 30%, the Social Democrats have 20%, but nobody's saying that just 50% of the people attended to the elections. You have an up and down, which you have to be very quickly to follow these up and down of the parties. Up to the 1980s, we have stable majorities over years and years, Christian Democrats, Social Democrats like this. You don't have these any longer. So to go more detail, the only one very sympathetic speciality of Germany, in difference to all the other German countries, we don't have a strong far right-wing party. That doesn't mean it's in Germany as well as in every European country. If you ask the people for their everyday life thinkings on migrants and things, it turns out 20 to 25% of all our societies are latent racist and latent fascist in their minds, 20 to 25%. Same is in Germany. But in Germany, it is somehow indecent to vote for the far right. We won't have a Front National, not because the people are not racist, but because we've managed by these kind of history politics since 68 that everybody thinks, yes, I think the Turkish people are not really human beings. We are human beings, not the Turkish ones. But it's indecent to vote for a political party openly saying that. Then we had what is on the left. We have a strong march forward. We had a strong march forward of the left party coming up nationwide to about 10%. Now it's up down to 2.5% in the last provincial election, and there is a real danger that they will lift the national parliament by the next election 2013. But why is that the case? I would say very briefly, the left party is boring. The left party has no offer to the young people. They have only an offer to the unemployed and to those people who, since 50 years, are sure that there has to be no war. Yes, that's right. That's completely right. But if that is all you have to say, that is not good for a party who wants to gain votes. It's just a boring party, and it has a personnel on its top, which just you look at them and you see, well, we are so much in crisis. We have so deep problems. My children won't have a job. I will lose my job. The wages are going down. And then you look in the television and you see the speak persons in the left party, and you immediately know these people won't change anything. So that doesn't mean what you have on the other side. You have these completely non-political movement of more younger people called the Pirate Party, which just say, and they say, transparency, participation, stop of these kind of political business. And they jump into the parliament by 8% within 2 years. And then not to forget, we have a jump up of the Green Party, which has moved to the right in all the last years, but we have a jump up of the Green Party from long time 7 to 8%, now 13%, 14%, Why is that the case? Everybody knows the Green Party is moving to the right, but the Green Party is the only political party which surely represents the post-1968 culture. Legitimacy of homosexuality, non-racism, democracy, participation, that's all still on the side of the left party. So if you see the strong coming up of the left party, up to 10% within a short time, the strong coming up of the pirates, the strengthening of this fucking Green Party, that means we have about 15, 20% of people looking for an alternative which is not presented by the boring left party, but which is in tendency left. And then look on the social struggles. We had, after years, we had no anti-nuclear energy movement in Germany any longer. Then we had a completely unexpected return of these movements. And we had an acceptance of militant ways of fighting by the majority of these movements. You have for years, you had this point, the majority of the movement is for peacefully walking on the streets, and a minority is the black bloc. At the moment, we have a kind of meeting together. So it's no longer really strong black bloc, but it's no longer just peacefully moving in the streets. We have that in the anti-nuclear movement. We had that in the every year demonstration against the Nazis. We have this kind in Dresden. We have every year we have strong demonstration just to evict the fascists out of the town. And we had a strong growth of militancy within large part of the movements which are not willing and used to militant actions. And the second, the last point at least to say, and that is to sum up, what is the situation? The idea we had with Blockupy Frankfurt, what is the strategic idea in it? Looking on the given conditions in Germany, we knew that for us it would make no sense at all to participate on the 12th of May. When 150,000 people will demonstrate in Barcelona, it makes no sense to go on the streets in Frankfurt with 10,000 people, because that will be just not a news at all. So our idea was to do it a little bit later, to do it with the 10,000 people we have at the moment, but these 10,000 people will come, and they will come for a demonstration which will not be a pure peaceful demonstration. It will not be a black bloc demonstration also. It will be somehow, the idea is to really block the bans. That is on the middle between a just symbolic and a really concrete action. But what we want to evoke is a sense of that things we have seen the whole year 2011. From Tunis on, from Cairo on, what was the point of 2011? We have a lot of local events where people, yesterday Tariq Ali said the revival of the masses, people coming together in the square of the town, interrupting ordinary life, interrupting the ongoing of these so-called politics, and demanding immediately a change. That is what's happening, but that is just half of the thing what happened. The other half is that all over the world, this was understood by millions and thousands, hundreds of thousands, all over the world, it was understood. So we had these dynamics from the Arab Spring to the Southern Europe, from the Southern Europe up to London, from London to Tel Aviv, from Tel Aviv to America. And even when you look on the demonstrations in Moscow, that were not at all leftists on the streets, but I think the demonstrations in Moscow without the Arab Spring and without Occupy, you would not have these demonstrations in Moscow. And what we try to do now in Germany is to present a sign that that is the thing. We have to be in a kind of transnational political, we have to create a transnational political while reacting on each other. Yeah? And we have to have a sense of that we have to make the difference. We have to re-establish that there is a choice, which is to say there is politics and there is an alternative. We have to demonstrate that, and we have to know that this has to be in a transnational cooperation. And I will finish with a point going back to the, I think now closed, but somehow still continuing sequence of the so-called altermondialist movements. After the global protest against the American invasion in Iran. That was 2002 or 2003, I'm not so good in, 2003. Yeah, we had the biggest anti-war demonstration ever. But they didn't change anything. The invasion happened. And after that, Arundhati Roy said, it was the mistake of the demonstrations that they did not understand, and she didn't say this in a sense, you made a fault. She said, it's our fault, we have to think about that. That was the sense. It was not a bad criticism. You are all stupid, why? They said, it would have been our task to understand that to stop the American invasion in Iraq is not only the job of the Iraqi people. It is our job all over the world, and we have to organize our demonstrations, our marches, our politics toward this aim. So, and I think the European situation at the moment, the front in Europe at the moment is located in Greece. That is the situation, and I won't think that the Greek situation is so much completely different. Tomorrow it was said, I think, by Eric. He said, next elections we will have Syriza on 25%. I'm not at all sure on that. We have Rifondazione in Italia. We had NPA first in France. Now we had Front of God. We had Left Party. What do you think, if you have 3 months propaganda in Greece, instability. We have to create stability. That is the last offer the powers have to the people, stability, security, because everybody knows there is no other offer. And that a lot of people will go for that. And I'm not sure if in the next elections Syriza will go back with 25%. Maybe it will fall down again. We have learned this by Rifondazione Comunista, by the left party in Germany. That does not mean that the left is away. That is this quickly up and down of post-democratic politics. And our weapon against this would be to create a transnational dimension of politics. And that would mean for all of us in Croatia, in Germany, in France, and in Greece to understand that the focal point at the moment is Greece.
Let me just stop you at this point,
yeah.
Because I want to put a question to Lorenzo. It's obvious from discussion that the left is kind of uncomfortable with this nation-state surrounding its political strategy. So, in your opinion, what are the concrete options in really transgressing the nation-state borders? What are the real options of uniting the left on a political platform which will enable us to circumvent all of the issues that are usually involved in national policies? You have worked a lot on these issues in text and on the ground, so perhaps a few comments on this.
Thank you. Yeah, I think this is absolutely the question to ask. And if the panel before us this morning was the pessimism of reason, I see our work today as being really the optimism of the will in a certain sense. And at least for those of us of a, let's say, Gramscian influence, we know that will, especially when it's translated in political practice, actually has the capacity to influence and radically transform the reasoning and the analysis as well. Now, the political situation is constructed primarily through processes, and undoubtedly the transnationalization, the capacity to build a transnational political action, a transnational subjectivity, perhaps, is one of the key contradictions we have today. I remember yesterday evening in the conversation between Žižek and Tarikali, both of them agreed that electoral processes are no longer enough. Undoubtedly, there needs to be a very strong pressure from social movements, from civil society, to accompany and transform the results of elections themselves. In my mind, one of the reasons why electoral processes are no longer enough is that we're witnessing a quite radical transformation of sovereignty in the European space, a shift in sovereignty from the national to not merely the transnational, but a space of diffuse sovereignty where it is not very clear who is in charge, whether it's a central bank, whether it's a transnational parliament or a hybrid institution like the European Commission or a certain consensus of the markets. And we need to find a way of relating to that transformation of sovereignty and applying political pressure at a level which is no longer that of the nation state. What that means, however, is that if we want to accompany the electoral processes with real practices on the ground, or practices stemming from social movements, autonomous influences, etc., these practices need to become truly European practices. They need to become truly transnational practices. Now, the bad news is that so far we have been really bad at doing this. And by us, I mean political parties. Really going extremely quickly, we all know that European political parties are extremely fragile. They are conglomeration of national parties that work a little bit like the European Council does, fragmentation between national lines. There is very little sense of a real European unity within the European political families, the European parties. But also, and even more importantly, national parties in Europe have been incapable of transnationalizing their own practice. I find it extremely sad that the only rejoice we have is that the Mercosur axis is now been replaced possibly with the Frangela axis, as if all that we can hope from the Europe of political parties is that the leader of one of the most important European nation states be replaced with a leader more akin to our cause. What I think should have happened is for national political parties to call something like a summit of peripheral parties. Why is it that we have seen a show in Paris with Hollande, with Bersani from the Italian PD and the leader of the German Social Democrat, but we have seen no space of convergence between Greek, Portuguese, Spanish, Romanian, Bulgarian, Italian political parties? That is the incapacity of political parties at a national level to think and act European. The same bad news is possibly true about trade unions. In the context of the greatest crisis since 1929, the context of the greatest dismantling of the welfare state and privatization of public services, a few weeks ago I was at a conference of trade unions in Brussels, and one of the leaders of the European Trade Union Confederation said, well, it's still a few years too early to think about and talk about a European strike. Well, it's not. It's too late already to talk about a European strike. And if European trade unions are unable to go beyond the national logic of the European Council in their transnational European meetings, that is a very, very big problem, which is a very big problem for the left. Civil society, and this is what where I want to focus the conclusion of the first intervention. We also have these problems. There could be 1,000 examples that can be given, but in my mind it's very clear the day after the attack on the Twin Towers in New York, and there were demonstrations throughout Europe saying we are all Americans. Well, now they're destroying a whole country, but I haven't seen a demonstration saying we're all Greek covering the whole of the European territory. The lack of solidarity between citizens is absolutely scary in my mind, as is the difficulty of social movements to go beyond just an episodic protest and enact a real transnational mid-term political process at a European level, which is what I want to say a last word about. Frankfurt. Whenever I think of Frankfurt, I think of Ponte Corvo, the Battle of Algiers, which I think is fitting to mention in this festival because it's a film festival. Last week it was a film festival as well. And what you see in Ponte Corvo very well is that the practice of terrorism, the practice of putting bombs in Algiers, was not an end in itself, but was meant to act as a wake-up call, as a bell for a popular mobilization and a popular uprising, which had been prepared in advance in very great detail and with a very great strategic and tactical planning. Now, episodes like Frankfurt, for me, have the function of being a wake-up call for European citizens and for European movements. Something is moving. In the center of the core European institutions, people are protesting, some violence might take place, the media impact might be strong, and that is absolutely essential. But that needs to be followed by a mid-term tactical and strategic vision of how we go beyond ephemeral, one-off protest episodes, and instead try to show that there is a united front for a transnational European alternative. The last sentence to say that, and maybe in the second round we can go into more detail on this, in thinking of what tactical tools we have at our disposal to enact this convergence of forces at a transnational level, one tool, this is by no means the only one, I only have time to mention one, so I will mention this one because it hasn't been mentioned today yet, is that of the European Citizens Initiative. As you know, the Citizens Initiative allows 1 million citizens from at least 7 European member states to present the European Commission with a legislative proposal for enactment. It's by no means a perfect tool. The Commission has political discretion. The European Council will never approve the most radical Citizens Initiative. But it is the first example of a transnational proto-pseudo-participative democratic practice that we have. Now, this proto-pseudo-transnational democratic practice we have can be used as a tool to mobilize citizens transnationally throughout Europe around a key set of systemic, of structural issues and contradictions that our continent faces. We have three or four that are already taking shape. There is one going directly at the heart of the attack on public services and privatizations that we see throughout the European Union for the defense of water as a fundamental right and a common good for all the citizens to be able to use. This is being accompanied by a wider movement on the idea of commons that goes beyond just the question of water and embraces public services and access to fundamental to fundamental goods and fundamental values. There is the building of a European convergence on basic income or minimum income as an attempt to give a response precisely to those young people that were being mentioned before, to give those young people an alternative to systemic unemployment reaching 20, 30, 40% or complete subservience to market forces or unacceptable job offers. There are ideas for a citizens' initiative against the detention of irregular migrants in the European Union. There are many more I don't have time to go into. But what the message that I want to send is that if we take seriously the idea of going beyond just a cahier de doléances, just a list of we are against this, we are in favor of this, and use the ECI, use the citizens' initiative as a tool, not simply to say what we're against and what we're for, but to build transnational alliances that collect millions of signatures to present a legislative proposal around these issues, maybe we begin to mobilize a sufficient number of people around very concrete issues, not just the idea of an alternative Europe, but income, migrant rights, access to water, public services. We manage to mobilize a sufficient number of people to make the message that there is a way out of the crisis, that there is a very concrete political alternative in this continent to suicidal austerities. We make this message begin to pass in people. And this is what we need to do, because it's no longer the time for 10,000 people to go and protest. It's the time for tens of millions of Europeans to be convinced that an alternative exists. Now, the good news for us is that the alternative actually really exists, and it's for us to try and make it happen.
Okay. Thank you, Lorenzo. I think now it's time for the audience to get involved, and I will take first three questions for our panelists. Please make these questions or comments brief so that we can move on as soon as they are answered. Tony? Yeah. Okay. Go. Tony, you're first.
I just like to ask panelists whether you think that we perhaps underestimate the capability of capitalism as shown in many historic economic works.
So I'm just wondering what the panelists think about the idea that are we not underestimating the ability of capitalism to create new markets, to monetize and commodify new areas, as we know in the, for example, a project for New America, the very historical, the right wing during the Bush years, maybe 10 years ago, when they said, look, we have the entire Africa, we have large segments of Asia, we have large segments of Latin America, which are really demonetized and decommodified. Actually, they haven't gone through another cycle, which China is now doing with the middle class. So when Thomas said about China, I just look at the stats in OECD and the rest. I mean, the exports are exploding. They are more than US in China. And the people in the finance world are saying there will be growth for a long time to come. Perhaps you're right, perhaps 10 to 15 years, but why not to think that capitalism is able, in order to be able to pose a good critique, to open up new markets? And you know, perhaps China tomorrow, I mean, if Germany produces highest quality technological machinery, China today, maybe somewhere else tomorrow.
Okay, this is a question for Thomas or for...
For Thomas.
Okay. Okay, Thomas, you can...
Immediate notes, should we not collect?
You want to...
I think we should collect.
Okay.
Hi, I have a question for a comrade from Greece. I didn't actually grasp if she is from Syriza or not, but my question would be, well, as Tsipras from Syriza said that, and the program is that they're against austerity measures, but they're also for staying in Eurozone. So my question would be, I don't know if you can answer that, is this like a tactical question, just saying that you want to stay in the Eurozone just not to be too radical because the people might not like it, or do you really think that it is possible to be against austerity measures and to lead a different kind of politics, not the way it is now, and to stay in Eurozone, because as we all know that there are a lot of economists like Kostas Lapavitsas that say that this is simply not possible. So my question would be, is this some kind of real politics, or is it, or does Syriza really think that they can stay in the Eurozone and have a different kind of economic policy? Thanks.
Gaining the needed hegemony that of our ideas that Elizabeth mentioned in her intervention, and being active in the social movements is a very delicate way to handle politics. And it is a fine art that we must be very careful how to do it. Because, obeying the rule of law is one extreme, but at the same time, I don't really appreciate the connection that was made before, which is comes from the old times. It's a completely different thing, planting bombs during the liberation movement of the 70s. We were all in favor of that. But completely different to throwing bombs during a Greek demonstration in a bank and killing three innocent people. So I think we should be very careful when we deal with these things. And certainly, as I said, judging between the two extremes. And second observation is that certainly nobody can assure that what happened in Greece with the radical left will continue in upcoming elections. It's not sure. I'm optimist, but I could also be pessimist. But I think that comparison with what happened to Rifondazione Comunista is critical, and we have here Alessandra that could also put her judgment on this. I think it's critical because what we try to avoid is to do, at least until now, what we thought was the mistake of Rifondazione Comunista. We had extreme pressure to enter into a government now to get some even minor achievements in our struggle, which would not be indifferent to the people. And we didn't do that. I think that if we did that, then probably we had been vanished in the next elections. But again, this is also something that one can judge according to the circumstances. Thank you.
Yes, a question for Thomas. You have mentioned that the green parties have a tendency towards the right. Can you please elaborate on that a little bit? What exactly is the reason that is happening?
Chester?
I think.
Yeah, okay. I think the three. I start with the last one. The Green Party somehow is representing those social groups strongly inspired by their lifetime, by the 68 revolt and the following up. Those people had managed to do 68. They had managed to bring about a lot of changes on the level of everyday life. They've managed to bring about a lot of changes in the consciousness about new problematics ranging from migration to ecology, on the one hand, and on the other hand, these people had managed to establish themselves in a good position in today existing society. So we have a kind of red-green middle classes. And how the struggle on these middle classes will end up will be one of the, to my mind, it's one of the central questions we have to solve. will we turn the red-green middle classes to the left? And the Stuttgart demonstrations we had in Germany was a clear sign for that, those people. That was red-green and even black-green middle classes protesting for months against authoritarian politics. Can we draw them to the left, or will they move over to the right? Is one of the decide. We have to struggle on that. I'm not sure how it's going on. The point is that you can have, like I think in is there not a guy in Netherlands who is on the one hand believing homosexual and anti-Islamic racist? These kinds of coalitions are thinkable. So we have to smash these kind of coalitions. The question, your question on this, I'm stronger at this. I can do it about my political position. On the one hand, I'm part of the network of the interventionist left, which is anti-parliamentarian militant left. On the one hand, I'm aligned to the left party because I'm on the scientific board on their foundation. I think we have to follow both paths, which was called double strategies years again. The central mistake of all the old conceptions of double strategy was that it has to be one body. So in Germany, it was said we have one leg going to the parliaments, one leg staying on the streets. This is a wrong conception because it's supposed to be one body. But we have to think about a double strategy which has the conflict in itself, but always a communication on this conflict. Yeah? We will not be on every topic, we will not be on the same side. But if we understand that to change society is a complex process, including parliamentarian procedures and the coming up of strong leftist party, as well as direct autonomy of the masses on the streets, that we need both of the things, yes? And we cannot have the things, both things together and always be on the same side. We have to have conflicts inside of us, and we have to have the acceptance of these conflicts in of this. And as long as we don't think that in the old days, you cannot go my way and I will not go your way, if we smash this position, if we leave it behind, I think we can have a try with that. Yeah? But I think in a Syriza party will fall apart if there is not an ongoing autonomy on the streets. And Syriza will not be in the position to be Syriza if it's just the articulation or even the representation of the streets. We have to be open for a conflict then and have both things together, somehow that. And then the last thing is this. I don't think that capitalism has an offer. They don't have any offer any longer. The only offer they have is security, stability. That will mean they will collect all the people around who somehow can survive, and they will not care on the others. I think just go to a film like Blade Runner. Yeah? What does Blade Runner teach us to us? Capitalism has no longer an offer for the majority of the people, but, and therefore we should not underestimate it, it can persist. Why not? That is Blade Runner. I'm not sure at all that we can topple capitalism in the next time. If we don't topple it, given the ecological crisis, given the destruction of subjectivity, given the destruction of sociality we have, we will move on in Blade Runner times. And Blade Runner times, if you remember the film, they can last for a very, very long time. So I don't underestimate, but I'm insisting that capitalism no longer has an offer, as it has that back in the 19th, after World War II, where you had the Soviet bloc and the West, which had to open, which had to have participation for the masses in consumerism, in social rights, in acknowledgement as part of society. I don't know, besides the fact of security, we should not underestimate this point of security, yeah? And that's what we have to properly have to see with them. If they are saying, you want security, you want the chaos. That is the power. I'm in fear for that power. So we have to create a good chaos which attracts the people. We have to convince the people that chaos is the thing we need. Because that is the only offer they have, stability.
Just a second. Okay. I will comment on two issues. The second will be the question of the comrade. And the first is the question about the sustainability of the electoral result that you had mentioned. And it relates to an intervention that I also heard this morning about how optimistic we can be about an electoral result which is now very good, but of which we cannot be sure in the future. Of course, we cannot be sure that this electoral result will be sustainable or will be better. We are hopeful for that. And what I mentioned was that from what we see now, it seems in the polls that it's quite probable. But the fact is that this is a challenge for us. And this, not only for us, it is a challenge now for the whole of Europe, because Greece now constitutes, as a laboratory that it is, as I said, constitutes in the political level a kind of experiment. So, and especially for the Greek left is a big challenge, because if now we become an example of big failure, it will condemn the ideas and the values of the left for some period, and this is a big burden now for us. Mm. But there is the idea that was expressed, as I said, also this morning, and it is a topic of discussion also in Greece, whether the people are have really changed, whether all these people that now voted for the left are really different people than the people that were voting the two big parties in other elections, the people that had nationalist, racist, or other kinds of ideas, if the people have really changed in one electoral battle. Of course, this is not the case. We know that, and we don't hallucinate that taking a percentage of 70% means that we have transformed the Greek society into a left society. This is not the case. But we have to know that this is a point that we are really starting to influence consciences. And that is what the left, for me, that's the biggest challenge of the left now. We are in a moment that, retreating to economism, the economic situation, the worsening of the everyday life of people is starting opening up some spaces for people to change the mechanisms of thinking. That is the their consciences. And we have to be ready to give a big battle in this field. And it is not only the struggles that we give in the streets in Greece and in Europe and the coordination of our forces that is needed. We also are giving a very big battle in the field of ideas and in the field of ideology. And this is a reason why I'm really proud of the campaign that Syriza made during all this time. And the reason is that it really insisted on this type of ideological issues, such as nationalism, such as racism, such as the opposition to concentration camps that both big parties were keen to promote. And we resisted. On this kind of thinking in the Greek society, and it is I think we have to claim all the time. It's not a given. on the second issue, this is the issue that starts from the currency. Let's say the choice to be inside or outside the Eurozone is an issue that has been debated very much in the Greek left. I think it's one of the most debated issues for a couple of years now, when the crisis started to really become very deep. And it may have started from Greece because of the economic situation how bad the economic situation was, but it was certainly a discussion that moved to other European countries. What I think is that after the result of the elections in Greece, after the reinforcement of the left in France, after the fall of the government in the Netherlands due to the austerity policies, and after all the efforts of resistance that we have seen around Europe and we have we will continue hopefully to see, we must be now more confident than ever that the choice that we made, that our left has made in Greece to claim for a continuum of the struggle at the European level was correct, was a correct choice, because it was because we participated in the European level that this kind of accentuation of the contradictions of neoliberal capitalism in Europe is now such a big shake inside the European construction and in the national struggles. I think that maybe I'm wrong, I don't know, but I'm thinking that this is perhaps a time that we are closer than ever to really capture a path for creating a different Europe. Because, as it has been said in the first panel, the EU is not an abstract thing we cannot think about. It's a coming together of neoliberal European governments that all together agree to move to a specific route. And it is very important that even starting from a small country like Greece, it will be interesting what will happen if people, the public factor, starts opposing, really opposing these issues, and start opposing them in such a level that this can be expressed at the governmental level. What happens if at some point we are hopefully so strong that we have a left government in Greece? What happens if other people are also influenced? If the left in France gains more power and all these policies are really shaking to their core, so I think that maybe this time the fact that our economies are so interrelated, that our societies communicate so much between one another, and the fact that we can be influenced by all the movements that happen around Europe, maybe this is now a chance that the unification, and I don't want to get into details about what is a European unification, but this kind of interrelation may perhaps start to work this time on our side. And I think that at this point, we should not retreat from the European level. That is, what we need to do now is not to take our own puzzles, each country, and move away and talk about national paths of growth, but really start to think about the path of an alternative Europe to which, as you said, we must give a content that is still under debate.
Okay, we
can also have a discussion between us, because we didn't say exactly the same thing on all. Just on Germany, I think that it's very important to understand that the German government did a big effort to integrate the most of the workers, people in a crisis management. They blocked any action. And we call this in German Krisenkooperatismus. And this is the method to use the split between the more stable workers and the precarious workers, because with the measures by the government, with milliards of euros, were paid the partial comment dit chômage partiel. Yes, thank you. And this has helped the stable workers to have the impression that they can escape the dramatic consequences of the crisis. In the same time, the precarious people, they were ejected, of course. And so, of course, one of the challenges for Germany, but for all Europe, if we want to change the balance of forces in Europe, we need to help also and to think on how we can help that the real class struggle in Germany can be more important on the side on the resistance, and there are different forms, different ways. You spoke on the Frankfurt initiative. I want to mention another initiative. There's a new kind of call from first personalities of the trade unions in Germany together with intellectuals and so on. They say now, it's new for months, we have to change policies in Germany and refound Europe. So this is important because we have to, it's in the core of the society also, and so we have to bring all this in movement. Okay. Second thing is on the transnational political subject and so on. I think there is no opposition between national and transnational. It cannot be because it's a new kind of complexity, but it's the reality, and we have to live with the complexity and try to find the complex answers to a complex reality. So everybody speaks on Greece, what will happen in Greece, and it's important for all the progressist Europeans. So if nothing happens in Greece, or if it takes a very bad way, it's a bad way for all of us. So we hope that the Greece will be able to, and we will help them to be able to not be isolated and under this pressure and so on. Okay. So it proves only that we need all that things progress there and there and there and there, and if it could be in all the countries in the same time, it would be ideal. But it doesn't minimize what happens in the countries. Everybody in Europe looked for, on the left, looked on the results of Mélenchon. Of course, why? Because it was a change of balance of forces for everybody. And so I agree completely with Elena that the reality is we cannot change like this the societies. So everybody hoped that we had a higher result than we had. But it's the same thing. We cannot imagine that from one day to the others, we can change completely the report inside the left and the ideas and all this. Okay. But we have to progress step by step, and every step in one of the countries helps to the other countries. And I think that we have in the same time to build European spaces. In the same time, but it's not contradictory. And we do it. We do it when we organize the joint social conference, which is an important space. A lot of you know this, cooperating with critical trade unionists and movements and so on. We had the annual conference in March this year. It's the same when we try to build a process for a European Alta Summit. Maybe it can become an important process, new process, because, of course, the ESF is in crisis, and we have to build up a new kind of process to be more energetic, not only to make forums, it's very important, but we have also to find out the convergences for alternatives and so on. So we try to build up a very open process of Alta Summit together from movements and political actors. There is also a political subject. It's the Jugend Left Party. Of course, it's difficult because there are so different traditions, and it's a party of parties. It's sure, but in the same time, it changes the parties, their members. Yeah, more or less. But and not enough, and not okay. No, but I will only say that there is no solution without this complexity, I think. And this we have to integrate in our thinking, in our strategic thinking. And the last thing is that on the question of hegemony, I think that, yes, we are right, our left, to try to put in the question of an alternative hegemony the question of changing the power. I don't agree with the idea that there is an opposition between a street and institutions. Of course, it's not the same space, but I think the confrontation line is between option for capitalism and against. It's very simply saying like this, but the confrontation is also inside the institutions. It's also inside. We see it in Greece, in the Greek Parliament, in the French Parliament. They are inside. It's not why you are a political force, you are on the other side. It's completely idiot. It's not why you are NGO, you are on the good side. You have very bad politicians, very bad NGOs, and you have good one, more or less good. Okay, we can, critical position is necessary, and autonomy of movement is necessary, but the struggle has to be a joint struggle. Because let's look for Spain. I'm very happy on this movement, but in the same time, the political reality is against. It's the opposite. So something is not, it's not the level we should try to obtain. So I think this is important. And just to finish, I think that we go to a very, very risky situation in Europe because the struggle is very, the confrontation is now very, very intense. And in this kind of situations, all can happen. And when I saw in the television what happened in Italy, the terrorist attacks, I think that this are always things when there is no, how to say, when you have to impeach that people move, this comes out. And I think that we don't, really we shouldn't be naive and we should do all in our own action to impeach that people can be afraid by violent actions and like this. So I think that non-violence of our side is very, very important.
Okay, and of course, your comment on this complex reality of Europe, right?
Yes, no, I like very much always making a metaphor to Pontecorvo, both because it's a great film, but also because it always wakes up people. What I want to be obviously very clear about is that it's a metaphor not at all for the violence of the film, which I think would be beyond any moral aspect, simply counterproductive politically in Europe today, but it's a metaphor to the necessity of going beyond a single moment of protest, a single mobilization, a single occupation of Puerta del Sol, and to instead think mid and long term in the construction of political structures that are able to channel the aspirations, the energy that comes out of a singular mobilization, be it in Puerta del Sol or in Frankfurt, and to channel these energies into a process that constructs a political space beyond the ephemerality of the singular moment, of the singular instance. And our task is to try and construct a political space that is transnational, that is European, to say the least, in this moment in time. And what we need to think very seriously about is how we do it and who is meant to do it. From an electoral perspective, from a party political perspective, ideally we would have a very strong European left party, which was not simply the sum of more or less powerful national parties, each with their own rhetoric, each with their own difficulties in coming together on a common platform, each with a constant reference to the national well-being and the national interest, but a singular European left party, which were able to truly give a glimpse of what a different articulation of the European space would look like, and to push for that articulation at the same time throughout Europe, mobilizing its own members and sympathizers from Portugal to Bulgaria, putting pressure at all levels, from the European institutions in Brussels to the local administrations in the city of Thessaloniki, but putting it with the same political strategy that would be a transnational and pan-European political strategy. We don't have that. That is something that needs to be constructed, and it's a very great task for politicians, for party members and sympathizers to think what that would look like. From the civil society perspective, the perspective of social movements, the kind of equivalent to this structural construction of a political space beyond the singular moment of the spectacle of the revolt, whatever it may be, is, for example, what happened in Italy recently with the water referendum, which you may have heard about. It's 10 years that people in Italy are protesting for the right to access to water. A couple of years ago, there was a very strong movement towards calling a referendum to ban a national law that would allow water to be privatized and sold to corporations that would run it on a for-profit basis. What this call for a referendum set to do was to transform an episodic set of local or more or less local protests into a mass movement that collected 1.5, nearly 2 million signatures to ask for the referendum, then ran the campaign for the referendum, convinced 29 million Italian voters to go and vote on the day of the referendum, and 96% of those voters to vote against the privatization of the water system. That is the creation of a political subjectivity, which is not the subject as the party or the trade union. It's a diffused civil society, bottom-up subjectivity that is able to act over a prolonged period of time and to follow one or a set of clear objectives throughout a prolonged period of time. That is what I think we need at a European level. And this is why I like the European Citizens Initiative, which is very far from being a radical or violent proposal. Actually, the Citizens Initiative is accused of being very reformist and totally in line with the institutional decision-making process. But the European Citizens Initiative has a similar process at its heart to that of the Italian referendum experience. It's a process which needs to be activated through a prolonged period of time, which requires movements, organizations, students, groups, precarious workers from throughout Europe to come together around a clear demand, a clear political reivindication, and to build the capacity to act together at a European level over a prolonged period of time, collecting millions of signatures from Bulgaria to Portugal, translating a concept into the different national or local political circumstances and situations. If we could imagine between now and 1-2 years' time, a limited set of such referendum-like mobilizations on key structural contradictions, from the question of income and access to labor to the question of privatization of public resources, the question of detention of migrants, which you were mentioning before as well, the question of financial reform, what we would be able to give people is the glimpse of an alternative Europe that is possible, made up of 4, 5, 6, 7 very clear demands hit the basic contradictions of the system we are fighting. And around those 6 or 7 demands, not simply organize a demonstration or a series of demonstrations throughout time, but organize a real transnational campaign, which has 12, 18, 24 months, 36 months as its time frame, and uses this time frame, uses this very clearly delineated horizon that 4 or 5 or 6 the clear demands gives you, to build the capacity of the European people to act as a political subject. And acting as a political subject is the only capacity of the European people not to be merely a subject, which is what they're trying to transform them into right now.
I think we have just about enough time for 1 or 2 short questions. But really short, because we are...
Yeah. As a point of information, which I think is interesting regarding the European solidarity, because I think we should not try to hide things that have happened, although they are not very satisfactory. For example, we had 2 international delegations of movements coming to Greece during this period of crisis. In one of them, Alessandra was present. Also, we had some British trade unionists who came to Greece. At the second level, on the political level, in most our rallies, we had politicians from the parties of the European left. We had Pierre Laurent, we had Gysi. We tried to give a signal of a European attitude in our struggle, and we were the only party that did that in Greece. And when the crisis started 2 years ago, we were the first, in fact, I had the honor to be together with the president of the party, who visited at the very moment the Bloco in Portugal and Izquierda Unida and the Communist Party of Spain. So don't, of course, we have not done everything, but we have tried to do something.
Actually, it's not a question, it's more of a summary of what Lorenzo Wright said. So basically what you're advocating...
really short comment. If
it is
a comment.
Very, very short. Okay, so what you're saying is that the people of Europe resort to direct democracy, i.e. referendum, in the fields where the national governments have failed. Right? That's the bottom line, if I understood you correctly. Just wanted to make it clear.
I know the time is very short. I think the nation state has failed on pretty much all accounts and will continue failing on pretty much every account. And the whole point of the attempt to reformulate the European Union as we understand it now is precisely to make the nation state fail on every account. The fiscal compact is a quintessential example of how, through a certain European constituent process, what used to be a particular economic viewpoint is now being constitutionalized in the constitutions of all the member states. That is a very clear example, in my mind, of the kind of Europe that a certain type of elite wants to build and is succeeding in building. What I think the referenda mobilization has a capacity to do is, on the one hand, to certainly tackle the questions the nation states no longer can do. And when it comes to reform of the labor market with income or the question of privatizations or financial reform, those questions can no longer be dealt at a radical level at a national level in Europe. So not only tackle those questions which have already transpassed the nation state, but in so doing, even if the mobilization fails because the proposed directive hits the European Council and is turned down, in that very process, find the capacity to construct the capacity to construct the possibility of the European citizens to act as a united political subject. And that for me is even more important than the actual capacity of the demand to be then transposed into European law. That is essential, but a prerequisite for that is for Europeans to be able to act as a political subject. And now we're not yet capable of doing that. And I think that a process such as that of the referendum, the European Citizens Initiative, is one of the tools that will enable us to do that. There are more. I just mentioned this because I know that the time here is very short.
But it's not working like this.
Ideally, yes. Yes. Maybe not flag, but platform, yes.
Yeah, short comment, yeah. Now, if we are really speaking on democracy in the sense of the people, where are the people, I think that we have to develop democracy there where are the people. And the people are not living in a general space, they are living in a concrete space. And it's not a plaidoyer for the national state alone, it's not at all this, but when I see what we had to do in the French campaign, let's take this example, we started with this, what we had to do to convince, to discuss with 10,000 people, this is not, it's very concrete, and there you create a change of ideas, and there you create a kind of change of there you can work for a new hegemony. So if we want to make campaigns, okay, I agree totally, we have to make campaigns, but what I found interesting, it was the campaign in Italy on the water, because it was really inside the society with the real people, with a lot of people, and it became a concrete movement. Okay, but it proves that this movement was in one society, you had the possibility to do it. And we have to look in, it's not sure that in another society exactly the same thing can be done in order to mobilize people. We have to find out what other things they make possible to change something, to make movements. And if you look, then we can see that there are the same kind of confrontation, because the question of water is a question of privatization and commons and so on, and you have the same question in France when you fight for hospitals and so on. So it's more complex. It's not possible to say every society in Europe in the same time the same thing with the same arguments. This, I don't think that this works, but we can be very intelligent and find out the common fundamental questions of the struggle, and then to build together movements, but it's not exactly the same movement in every place in every time with the same forms and so on.
Okay, just a short reply by Lorenzo, yeah?
Very short. I think this is precisely the point. It's a process of political and conceptual convergence at European level. To give you a very concrete example, with my organization, with European Alternatives, tomorrow, this is why I cannot be here tomorrow, we're organizing a forum on the commons in Cluj-Napoca in Romania, which is the end point of a process for the last 6 months of working with the movements against ACTA, the movements against the privatization of the health service, and the movements for Roja Montana against the exploitation of the mountain by a gold mine, to try and link them with the European and Italian equivalent struggles on the commons, from Val di Susa to the water movement. The next day, I'm in Sofia for another forum on the commons, which tries to do precisely this work in Bulgaria. The day after, I'm in Berlin for another forum on the commons, which continues this process. Now, we are in the process of running a festival which is called Trans Europa and takes place in 14 cities, which has precisely this objective. But this is our year-round work. And this is precisely what a referendum campaign, a citizens initiative campaign, should do. It's not just a question of coming up with a slogan and mobilizing citizens around the slogan. It's a question about explaining how, in a post-socialist context such as that of Romania, you can develop a political vocabulary that is in harmony, in synthony, with the vocabulary that is used in France or that is used in Italy, and then out of this convergence of the political vocabulary, have a political convergence that is able to transform this into a political body able to act as such. It's a long-term process. This is why I said I like to think midterm. But this is what we need to achieve. Otherwise, we'll just be not even individual nation states, but individual citizens in Europe, and we'll be trampled over.
Okay, thank you, Lorenzo. I would like to thank all of our panelists. We will continue this discussion on the crisis in Europe at 3 o'clock here. I hope to see you all again. Thank you.